Okay, guys, while you're finding your seats, let's start with our next speaker. He has the name I like to say the most. He's Jorrit Vandervan. And yeah, take it off, man.
Thank you very much. Is my audio working? Yes, it's working. All right. Good morning, everybody. Welcome to my talk about Dapr, which promises to make microservices easier. I'm already introduced, but my name is Jorrit van der Ven, and I'm a software developer at a company called JDriven in the Netherlands, where we mostly work on JVM languages such as Kotlin. And I'm living in near Rotterdam in the Netherlands. But we're not for me here, we're here to talk about Dapr and to tell you why microservices need to be easier. We need to go back to the 1990s to a company called Books R Us. And Books R Us was just a plain brick and mortar bookstore. And they discovered this thing called the internet. And they saw it and they thought, well, this looks pretty promising. This might actually become a big thing. So maybe we can start selling our books over there. So they called their smart nephew to build them a website. And well, a few weeks later, there it was. They had their first website online. So mind you, this is the 1990s, so it doesn't look that nice. But it actually worked well, and they started selling books, and it was quite popular. So if you look at what that smart nephew built, it looked a bit like this, if you look at the architecture. It was just a database and one big piece of code with everything in it. HTML, probably Perl, some JavaScript, you name it. It was in there. It was just one big application. And this worked well for the next coming years. But yeah, after a few years, the website became more popular and people started complaining that the website looked old-fashioned and it became slow. So they hired a front-end engineer to make it look a bit nicer. Well, that front-end engineer saw the code, started laughing and said, yeah, this is really not how we build applications anymore. You need to separate these things. So you need to have a separate backend, separate front-end, and then I can work with it. So they started working on that. And well, after a few weeks, it looked a bit like this. So separate front-end, separate backend, still one database, some nice APIs between them. And well, it worked fine. And many more customers came to the website. And well, it worked fine until it didn't anymore. So after a few years, again, things started to get slow. And well, the website went black on Black Friday. And they really needed to scale up their website. So they hired another developer. And they looked at the backend code and started laughing again. Yeah, this is not how we do things anymore. Nowadays, we have this thing called microservices, and microservices are going to fix all your problems. So they started working on that, and a year later, well, there it was, a microservice architecture. So they split up all the different parts of the application to separate microservices, and of course, these developers go to conferences as well, so they put some NoSQL databases in there because, yeah, why not? And they put this thing live, and what do you think? Yes, exactly. It still didn't work properly. Because, yeah, it didn't really became easier. And there are still a lot of problems with these microservice architectures, especially if you build it this way. Nothing is scalable. There's some shared state here somewhere between services. So they hired yet another engineer. And, well, they made some changes to it. And now it looked like this. And now it started working. So the order service was quite CPU heavy. So they had to scale it horizontally, and they removed all the shared state and put it in a Redis database. And now finally things started working. But yeah, do you really think this is easier than the thing they started with? Is anyone who says this is easier? No, I thought so, nobody. And actually, with this thing after split up, there are a lot of points that can go wrong. So for example, if you have your services, you have any state in them, they're not stateless, you can't scale them. So that's a problem. You have problems with scalability. If you scale them horizontally, you need to know where they are. So you need something with service discovery. So shared state, you have to extract it from your services. You have to put it in a separate place. things can go wrong, of course. We're still using computers and it's made by humans, so somebody could pull a plug somewhere, some configuration could go wrong, and we can have communication issues between the services. And when something like that happens, you don't want your application to die entirely. You just want to have some graceful degradation there. So you need to take care of that. Well, secrets management, of course, if you have a lot of services and you have passwords and API keys everywhere, you don't want to put them in your code. Please, nobody do, hope nobody does that here. Because if you put your secrets in your Git repository and somebody misconfigures your GitHub account and makes it public, then yeah, you're screwed and everybody knows all your passwords. So you need something for that. Well, if you have a lot of requests between your services and something goes wrong, you need to know what happened. So you need traceability. And all these cross-cutting concerns have to be implemented in every microservice, which is difficult, especially if you're not using the same programming language everywhere, because you can't write like a shared library, but you have to implement it everywhere. And that's where Dapr comes to the rescue. Dapr stands for Distributed Application Runtime, and it promises you to make it easier to write microservices. Well, just to give you some facts about Dapr, Dapr was originally built by Microsoft. Well, I'm a Java guy, so well, the fact that I'm talking about a Microsoft thing is kind of interesting. It was first released in 2019, so just in time for COVID. And the first stable release was, I think, in 2021. Nowadays, it's part of the Cloud Native Computing Foundation, so they're maintaining it. It's now an open source project. And for those who don't know what the Cloud Native Computing Foundation is, it's part of the Linux Foundation, and they support open source projects financially and with developers. So how does Dapr help you to make it easier to write these microservices? Well, what they do is they provide several building blocks to provide functionality to your application. And these are all within Dapr, and you can just call them via either an HTTP API or a gRPC, a Google RPC API. And because of that, that API, it doesn't matter in which language your application has been built. So if either it's Java or .NET or Go or maybe some really obscure other language, it doesn't really matter. And because Dapr was built in Go, it can basically run on everything. So all the clouds are supported, but you can also run it in your own Kubernetes environment or maybe even just on bare metal machines or on your local development machine. And it does that by running a small service next to your application as a sidecar. So that means that when your application starts, there's another small application besides it, and your application only communicates with that little sidecar. That also means that there is no Dapr runtime in your application, so you don't need to add external libraries to your code. Actually, you can remove all the external libraries from your code and only call Dapr. Now, as you can see, there's a small asterisk there, and that has a reason, because there are some SDKs available, but those are not really required. They're only there to help you make these calls to the Dapr sidecar. So there's a client SDK, which helps you call stuff. So like sync communication, you request something, you get something back. And there is a server extension available for certain languages, which help you to be invoked as a service. And there's an Actor SDK, but because time is limited today, I'm not going to talk about that, unfortunately. So yeah, there are SDKs available for pretty much all the popular languages. And as I said, it's not required to use this. So if you're using Ruby or I don't know what, you can just call the API. So let's just take a small look at the building blocks that are there. And after that, we're going to do actually a live demo to see how you can fit Dapr in your application and how it works. So first, I think that's the most important one, the service invocation. It's basically calling another method or API in another service. So how would you do that with Dapr? Well, normally, if you don't use Dapr, you just call the other service. So in this case, I want to call the create method on the order service app, and normally you would just call that. Now with Dapr, you call an invoke order service with method create on the Dapr sidecar. Then Dapr will find the service for you and call the create endpoint. Well, you might think, okay, this is nice, but what do I get from this? This is just the same thing I did with extra steps. Well, actually, Dapr does quite a lot for you this way. So all the connections between the services are now encrypted using mutual TLS encryption. So you don't have to take care of that anymore. Dapr also has service discovery. So you just say the name of the service, but you don't know where, you don't have to know where it is. Dapr will find it for you. Also, load balancing is there. So if there are multi instances of that service, it will just pick the next one. If this request will fail, there's an automatic retry for you. And if it will keep on failing, there's also a circuit breaker mechanism that will help you. So that's all the things you don't need to implement in your application anymore. Dapr will just handle that for you. Next one, state management. Again, a microservice needs to be stateless. So if you want to store state anyway, for example, if you have a web shop and you need to store a shopping cart, you can't do that in your service. You need to put it somewhere else. Well, with Dapr, you can basically, again, call the Dapr sidecar, say, okay, I have some state I want to store. So for example, I want to store Heapcon with value Belgrade to the conferences store. And Dapr will just take care of it. And in this case, I've shown, I used Redis as a state store, but a lot of other state stores are supported as well, because it's good to know that Dapr doesn't implement all these different things itself. It's basically just a facade to make a bridge between another technology and your application. So if you want to get something back, you can also just use a HTTP GET and get the value back. Well, as I said, Redis is not the only one supported. Actually, I think, I don't know, I can't come up with anything else, but these are all supported. And of course, all the cloud-native things on Azure or AWS are also supported. Also, there's support for strong and eventual consistency. So it uses HTTP headers to determine if it should be last right wins or stuff like that. And you can actually give a time to live with it. So if you have a web shop and then you create a shopping cart, of course, if somebody comes back after half a year, you probably want to clean that shopping cart. So you can say, okay, store this shopping cart, but automatically delete it after 3 days. Also, encryption is supported, and it's a query API. So if you want to look for all conferences in Belgrade, using the previous example, you can also search for that. And it's all mapped to the underlying implementation of your state store without knowing that it's even Redis that's behind it. Well, I just shown you a service invocation, but I think most microservices landscape don't want to actually call other services directly. Most of the time you want to like post an event up on an event bus, and then some other service will pick that up and process it for you. Well, of course, that's also supported. So again, you can just simply call an endpoint or make a post to an endpoint saying, I want to publish something on the order pub sub bus with type checkout, put some data in it, and then Dapr will invoke another method on another service to post that data. And now you might be thinking, how does Dapr know that if I post something to the checkout endpoint, it should be posted to another service's checkout endpoint? Well, you can configure that using YAML files. So you ship some configuration with the sidecar, and that states, okay, if you have something like the order pub sub environment on the topic orders, if you get some message, then post it to the checkout endpoint of your service. And with the scopes, you can even say, okay, this is valid for all the services of type order processing or checkout. But of course, we're developers, so we don't like YAML files. So you can also just add an annotation if you use the SDK. So this is like a Spring REST controller in Kotlin. And I can just add one annotation here that states, if you get a message on topic orders on the pub sub name order pub sub, then post it to this REST endpoint. And you can just define what the REST endpoint looks like below. So it's just one annotation to receive data from a pub sub messaging system. Well, again, there's a support for a lot of different kinds of messaging systems. So all the popular ones, Apache Kafka, Apache Pulsar, RabbitMQ, Redis Streams, MQTT if you're using something like IoT, and all the cloud things all supported. And it's good to know that Dapr automatically wraps all your events into cloud events. And is anyone here familiar with cloud events? No? Ah, well, Cloud Events is a W3C standard for events in JSON. So it will automatically wrap everything you put in there in a cloud event, unless you turn it off, of course, but you can just turn it off. Also support for dead letter topics. So if something can't be delivered, then it will automatically report it to another topic. So a service can pick it up and, well, you can take a look at it or just discard it. And of course, messages can still have a time to live. Next one I want to look at is the resource bindings. And I think resource bindings are really powerful because with resource bindings, you can extract all the third-party SDKs from your application. So given the example of a web shop, when somebody orders something, you want to send an email. For example, you can use SendGrid for that. But to be honest, anyone here experienced with the SendGrid API? Yeah, well, their SDK, I'm not really a big fan of it. And there are, in a big application, there might be tens of hundreds of external SDKs in your application, which can come with their own dependency problems or vulnerabilities. With resource bindings, you can just extract them from your application. So you can just configure that in Dapr, and by calling an endpoint on Dapr, you can send an email without having to have any configuration for this in your application, no dependencies, and no secrets. So these resource bindings can be either input, output, or both. So you can have like a messaging system or maybe an AWS S3 bucket or Apple push notifications. And you just call the endpoint and Dapr will just handle the rest for you. So retries, failure conditions, everything is supported and will be handled for you. Well, of course, you might be wondering, then how do I configure this? Because, yeah, there must be some magic there, but can't be all magic. So again, you can just configure this using a YAML file, which you ship with the container. So in this case, I'm using the SendGrid API. I say, okay, I have a binding for SendGrid. I want to have some defaults there. So if I send an email, I'd like to see that it's sent by me. I configure the API key via a secret, which we'll come back to later. And now, if I just take a look at the Dapr documentation, I see the only thing I need to post to Dapr is a piece of JSON code which says, okay, I want to create an email, I want to send the recipient, the subject, and the body. And the rest is handled for me. As I just said, the API key can also be configured to be retrieved from a secret store. So that means that your application will never receive that API key. So if you have any vulnerabilities or source code leaks, then still that secret can't be retrieved from your application. So I think it greatly improves security. So to do that, you can either get it from via the REST API, but then of course the secret is still in your application, so not that great. Or you can use the Dapr YAML configuration to make a reference to the secret, and then Dapr will retrieve that secret from your secret store. Dapr has its own secret store, but just like a plain text file with all your secrets in there. So I only recommend to do that for development, local development only. But luckily, the Kubernetes secret store or the HashiCorp secret store or the cloud secret stores are all supported. So, demo time. I prepared the example I got from Books R Us. I made like a simplified version of their microservice architecture with a front end, three services, a Redis database, and some SendGrid APIs to send an email. And this is always the tricky part, of course. Let's see. Yeah, there we go. Where's my browser? There it is. No, I don't want any updates. Of course. Get lost. So this is our awesome website. Let's just quickly verify if the code is running. Yes, it is. So I see some books. Well, of course, I like Kotlin, so I want to buy a book about Kotlin. I also like old program languages, so yeah, let's introduce myself to Fortran 90 because, well, that's not supported by Dapr, so I want to learn about it, and I can order it via this beautiful website. As you can see, it will send the order, my shopping cart will be emptied, and I will receive an email. All right, so let's Dapperize this, because what we want is this. We want to have method invocation via Dapr. We want to store data in the state store via Dapr, and we want to send an email to SendGrid via Dapr. Well, I wanted to do a live coding here, but I only have 30 minutes, so to make things speed up a bit, I'll do it like this. So in your original service, you probably have some kind of REST call. Here I use Kotlin demo. To just call an API and then handle some problems if stuff goes wrong. With Dapr, you can remove that. You can basically say, well, this is my client SDK. Invoke a method on service shopping cart. The method name is cart/customer ID. I don't want a body. I want to do HTTP GET, and I expect a shopping cart back. And well, that's it, basically. Dapr will just do that for us. Now, next up is the Redis SDK. We can just remove all the dependencies. Then instead of Redis JSON GET or Redis GET with escape, blah, 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 we can say, well, give me a state. And as you can see, actually, it's more code in Dapr than for Redis, but that is because to make it clear what it does, I just split it up. And otherwise, it wouldn't fit on the screen as well. So we can say, give me the state from a certain state store with a key, and I expect a shopping cart back. And as you can see, Dapr has been built non-blocking. So in this case, my application is just like a regular application, so I have to wait until the value is returned. But if you use like RxJava or Kotlin coroutines, then you can use the non-blocking stuff. And of course, we want to remove the SendGrid data, API, so we can get rid of all the SendGrid API stuff. And of course, yeah, you can see in the top right, the API key. We can also remove that from our application. Add a small YAML config file to say who sends the email, what should be the name of the sender, the API key retrieved from the secret store. And then call, make the call from our application. So in this case, again, we say Dapr invoke binding. We give the name of the binding. We say we want to create an email. We add the body. The metadata contains the recipient. And we don't expect anything back. So we say it's a unit. Well, in Kotlin, a unit is basically what a void is in Java. And then we wait until it finishes. All right. Well, I can actually show you that it is working. So there it is. I'm going to stop this. Then I hope you can see it from the back, but I'm just going to check out another branch. And of course, we need to compile that as well, otherwise it won't work. Yeah, this is why I didn't do the live coding, because otherwise you would all have been looking at a compiler screen, but it shouldn't take too long. This is always the interesting part. Will it compile? All right, well, it does, luckily. And I already showed you this file, and I'm just going to, let's see, I'm going to just put it in presentation mode so you can see this. This is the, for local development, Dapr supports something, a file like this, and you can just state, how do I, or which services should I start in my local development environment? So In this case, I want to start a catalog service, a shopping cart service, and two order services to show you that you can actually scale horizontally. All right, so let's just start that. And I'm going to switch off presentation mode now, otherwise you can't see the console. And I can run that using, let's see, Dapr run command. So I say Dapr run a file, and that's on my current path, so I'm just going to start it. All right, so as you can see, it's starting all the services now. And I'll just switch back to the bookstore. Reload it just to be sure. And again, I can, well, this time I'm going to buy a book about Java because I haven't programmed Java in a while now, so I want to learn what's new. Then I can order the book. And as you can see, it worked. And I might even receive an email. Yeah, there it is. So yeah, it's actually the correct one. So, okay, but what did we get for free now? So first of all, we got service discovery. So if I take a look at the Dapr dashboard, which ships by default with Dapr, I can see that I have actually two order services running. I have a shopping cart service and I have a catalog service. And they're all running for about a minute now. But I also can see all the components that are running. So I have something that sends the confirm email. I have the state store and the pub sub, and the secret store, which is just local. But also, I have tracing now in my application. So Dapr ships with Zipkin as well. And Zipkin can show you what the interaction is between other services. So in this case, if I run this query, I can actually see, okay, I have different kinds of services here, and I can see all the communication between them. So apparently there's a lot of communication between the shopping cart and the state store. There is not a lot of communication between my order and the external SendGrid API. But I didn't have to build anything for this to get this. It's just out of the box. No configuration at all. And besides this, of course, we got a health check endpoint automatically added. We got encryption and all the things I already explained, so resilience, timeout, stuff like that. So some of you who might be familiar with like Kubernetes and service meshes things, well, this sounds a bit like Istio to me. And actually, there is some overlap between service meshes and Dapr, but Dapr is not a service mesh. And actually, Dapr can integrate really well with, for example, Istio. So in that case, all the like the tracing is done by your service mesh in your infrastructure, and Dapr will just provide easy access to it or add some stuff to it. And I think the main difference is the service mesh is like focused on the infrastructure, while Dapr is really developer-centric. So it's mainly configured by the developers, while your service mesh is basically handled by an infrastructure team in your company. So the big question is, this looks all nice, but should I use it in my next project or in my company? Well, from my experiences, I think the learning curve was really not that steep, so you can really get started quite quickly with it. There's the documentation is really good, so it's really easy to start with. And if you have a project that uses different programming languages for an application, so for example, you have like a service layer between your front end and your back end written in Node.js, you have your application in either .NET or Kotlin or something else, and you have some data scientists who are working with Python or R, then they can all use the same configuration, the same infrastructure without any differences in the configuration. And what's really nice in Dapr, it's not like an everything or nothing solution. So I've shown you some building blocks, but if you don't want to use them all, that's fine. You can just say, okay, I want to use the pub sub, but I don't want to use the method invocation, or I don't want to use the secret stores. And that also makes it really nice to move to or move from Dapr. So if you start using it, decide you don't like it, you can just move away again with block by block. Also, it's open source, so there is not really a vendor lock-in. And that project is backed by Microsoft, so you know there's a party with a lot of money behind it, so they won't just stop, probably. Some disadvantages I found 3 minutes. Dapr is a bridge between another system and yours. So there's always some additional latency. While the communication between Dapr and the other service is all local, so it won't be a lot. So if you work like with high frequency trading, I probably wouldn't use Dapr for that. But then again, you probably won't use microservices. As a Java or Kotlin developer, I found out that the Java SDK is not really Kotlin proof. So sometimes there's a name conflicts, or you can't use the Kotlin classes, but you have to use the Java classes, stuff like that. And I think the main reason not to use it as a Java developer is that the adaptation is still a bit low for the Java environment. I think in the .NET world, everybody knows about Dapr and is already using it. And if you tell about Dapr to Java developers, it's like, whoa, I didn't know this. If you are working at a startup and your time to market is really important, then yes, take a look at Dapr. If you have a polyglot microservice landscape, yes, look at Dapr. If you have a project that uses like service invocation without any circuit breaker, stuff like that, and it's problematic, yes, you can use Dapr, because you can also just change the URLs to the Dapr sidecar URLs, and then automatically you get all this stuff for free without changing your code. So if you're only using Java in your project, not sure if you should directly migrate to Dapr. You can take a look at it, but probably not dive into it directly. And if you are working with like rare real-time requirements, then yeah, check the performance before migrating. Unfortunately, I don't have the exact numbers available what the edit latency is, but you should check that for your own project. So concluding, if you want to learn more about this, take a look at their website or the YouTube channel of Dapr, because they created lots of tutorials, really good information and really easy to start with. Well, we handled some of the building blocks. There are a lot more. And so if you are interested in that, take a look at those. And that leaves me with to say thank you for being here. And if there are any questions, please ask. Thank you. Now, I know there were some questions already on the app, so maybe we can...
Yeah, we can switch to Q&A on the app if you're going to be kind enough to answer them.
Yeah, sure, no problem.
Yeah, cool, guys. So, thank you, Jorrit.
No problem. It was a pleasure to be here.
As you see.